In December 2015, the Falcon 9 rocket delivered 11 communication satellites to orbit, and the first stage returned and landed at Landing Zone 1, the first ever orbital-class rocket landing, making the commercial spacecraft a reality. Curious to know more about Falcon 9 and reusable launch systems? Keep watching. It's crucial to understand how rockets really work along with their launch stages in order to appreciate the significance of reusable launch systems. First of all, there are four major systems in a full-scale rocket: the structural system, the payload system, the guidance system, and the propulsion system. The structural system or frame is similar to the fuselage of an airplane. The frame is made from very strong but lightweight materials, like titanium or aluminum, and usually employs long stringers that run from the top to the bottom, and they are connected to hoops which run around its circumference. The skin is then attached to the stringers and hoops to form the basic shape of the rocket. It may be coated with a thermal protection system to keep out the heat of air friction during flight, and to keep in the cold temperature needed for certain fuels and oxidizers. Additionally, fins are attached to some rockets at the bottom of the frame to provide stability during the flight. The payload system of a rocket depends on the rocket's mission. Most of the rockets are specified to launch satellites with a wide range of missions, such as communications, weather monitoring, spying, planetary exploration, and observatories like the Hubble Space Telescope. Moreover, special rockets were developed to launch people into Earth orbit and to the surface of the Moon. The guidance system of a rocket may include very sophisticated sensors, onboard computers, radars, and communications equipment in order to maneuver the rocket in flight. Many different methods have been developed to control rockets in flight. For example, the V2 guidance system included small vanes in the exhaust of the nozzle to deflect the thrust from the engine. However, modern rockets typically rotate the nozzle to maneuver the rocket. The guidance system must also provide some level of stability so that the rocket does not tumble in flight. The propulsion system constitutes most of the full-scale rocket's body. There are two main classes of propulsion systems: liquid rocket engines and solid rocket engines. For example, the V2 used a liquid rocket engine consisting of fuel and oxidizer or propellant tanks, pumps, a combustion chamber with nozzle, and the associated plumbing. On the other hand, the space shuttles Delta II and Titan III all use solid rocket strap-ons. These various rocket parts have been grouped by function into structure, payload, guidance, and propulsion systems. However, there are other possible groupings where engineers often group the payload, structure, propulsion structure, and guidance into a single empty weight parameter for the purpose of weight determination and flight performance. The remaining propellant weight then becomes the only factor that changes with time when determining rocket performance. Secondly, rockets don't work by pushing against the air, since they also function in the vacuum of space. Alternatively, rockets take advantage of momentum, or how much power a moving object has. To picture this in your head, you can make a simple analogy. Imagine yourself standing on a skateboard. If you throw a basketball in one direction, you and the skateboard will roll in the opposite direction to conserve momentum. And the faster you throw the ball, the faster you roll backward. Rockets work by expelling hot exhaust that acts in the same way as the basketball. The exhaust gas molecules don't weigh much individually, but they exit the rocket's nozzle very fast, giving them a lot of momentum as a result. The rocket moves in the opposite direction of the exhaust with the same total oomph. A rocket makes exhaust by burning fuel in its engine. Unlike airplanes' jet engines, rockets are designed to work in space. They don't have intakes for air, and they bring along their own oxidizers, which are substances that play the role of oxygen in burning fuel. The rocket's fuel and oxidizer are called propellants. Thirdly, there are at least two stages in the launch system of spacebound rockets. They are sections stacked in a shared cylindrical shell, and each stage has its own engines, which can vary in number. For example, the first stage of SpaceX's Falcon 9 rocket has 9 engines, while the first stage of Northrop Grumman's Antares rocket has only 2 engines. You may wonder, why do rockets have stages in the first place? And the answer is simply because the amount of fuel it takes to launch a rocket is so high. Therefore, modern rockets use a staging launch system, and once the stage has emptied out all of its fuel, it detaches and returns to Earth so that the second stage can keep going without having to drag along the extra weight of the empty fuel tanks. The first stage gets the rocket out of the lower atmosphere, sometimes with the help of extra side boosters. It's considered to be the biggest and most powerful section of the rocket, since it must lift the entire rocket with its cargo or payload and any unused fuel. The faster a rocket goes, the more air resistance it encounters. However, the higher the rocket goes, the thinner the atmosphere gets. These two factors combined mean that the stress on a rocket rises and then falls during a launch, peaking at a pressure known as max Q. For SpaceX's Falcon 9, max Q occurs at 80 to 90 seconds after liftoff, at altitudes between 7 and 9 miles. Once the first stage has done its job, the rocket drops that portion and ignites its second stage. The second stage has a lot less to transport, and it doesn't have to fight through the thick lower atmosphere, so it usually has just one engine. At this point, rockets also let go of their fairings, the pointed cap at the rocket's tip that shields what the rocket is carrying, aka the payload, during the launch's first phase. Historically, most of a rocket's discarded parts were left to fall back down to Earth and burn up in the atmosphere. However, starting in the 1980s with NASA's Space Shuttle, engineers designed rocket parts that could be recovered and reused. Private companies, including SpaceX and Blue Origin, are building rockets with first stages that return to Earth and land themselves. The more that a rocket's parts can be reused, the cheaper rocket launches can get. Before explaining Falcon 9's launch system and its first landing mechanism, be sure to like or dislike the video so that we can continue to improve our content and make these videos better for you. Plus, be sure to subscribe to the channel and don't forget to hit the bell button so that you don't miss any of our weekly videos. Even as SpaceX became the first private company to provide a cargo delivery service to the ISS, a mission that was furthered in October 2012 as the company launched its second trip to the station, it was already at work on its next giant leap, a reusable orbital spaceship. An important element in SpaceX's reusability goal is the Grasshopper program, a part of which is the hopping Falcon 9 rocket. The system was tested in October 2012 and consists of a standard first stage with a single Merlin ID engine in its tail and landing legs added on. The initial test hop was all of 2 meters, but it was the first step in the company's reusability plan that will give its boosters the ability to launch payloads into orbit and then land robotically so they can be refueled and launched again, instead of plunging back to Earth and being destroyed. Each of Falcon 9's 2 stages would fly back to Earth in a controlled maneuver, using reserve propellant to make a gentle touchdown on retractable legs. If successful, SpaceX could bring airline-style operations into LEO and significantly reduce the exorbitant cost of leaving the planet. An LEO reusable system would be nothing short of a game-changer in an industry whose costs are difficult to fathom by the average person on the street. So let's put it into some perspective. Imagine if the airline industry threw away an airliner every time it flew across the Pacific, and you get some idea of the state of transportation to LEO. Small wonder that space tourists have to pay upwards of $30 million per flight. But if SpaceX can spread the cost of a spacecraft over several flights, access to LEO could become much, much cheaper, perhaps even opening the door to routine and reliable access to space. If SpaceX were able to achieve that, then manned spaceflight takes on a whole new look, and it opens the door to a whole lot of new users whose business plans suddenly become practical. Grasshopper may be on the right track to realizing reusable flight, but for the system to revolutionize spaceflight, it will have to be cost-effective and achieve shorter turnaround times, in the order of a few days rather than weeks. Whatever happens in the development of Grasshopper, the system is in stark contrast to the LEO vision put forward by Congress. Managed by NASA but designed by Congress, the Heavy Lift Space Launch System, SLS, aka the Senate Launch System, is a monster rocket touted as the government vehicle that will launch astronauts to LEO sometime in the 2020s. Given the history of government-designed spacecraft, it is likely the first manned launch of the SLS will be later rather than sooner. But will Grasshopper be operational any earlier? Grasshopper will be used to test reusable vertical takeoff and landing flight regimes. Will consist of a Falcon 9 first stage powered by a single Merlin ID engine, and will be equipped with a landing structure comprising of four steel legs. The proposed range of testing will last 3 years, beginning with flights to 75 meters and culminating in flights to a maximum altitude of 3,500 meters. By way of comparison, one of Blue Origin's vertical takeoff and landing test vehicles was lost at 13,700 meters or 4,500 feet. While traveling at Mach 1.2. Blue Origin's attempts, and Armadillo Aerospace's among others, at realizing a similar vehicle suggest that what SpaceX is trying to achieve will be anything but easy. One of the first hurdles will be to recover the Falcon 9 first stage, which may prove more difficult than it sounds since the vehicle's flight profile tends to hit the atmosphere in a belly flop position, severely damaging the first stage. One of the solutions to this problem is to restart three of its engines after stage separation to slow the first stage, thereby easing the transition into the atmosphere. If this procedure were successful, the booster would descend to a tail-first powered landing. Assuming SpaceX can recover the first stage successfully, they then have to return the second stage safely, a more demanding task due to the much greater re-entry speeds. SpaceX plans to deal with these challenges by firing an extendable engine and adding a heat shield at the top of the second stage, followed by a powered landing using small thrusters on the perimeter of the base. SpaceX did succeed in landing the first stages safely, and the key to that success will likely reflect the company's unique corporate culture and deliberate manner that enable it to follow a plan, allowing it to pursue reusability through the normal course of its operations by means of a partial development effort. Another benefit of SpaceX's business plan is that as long as the company can launch its vehicles, it will be able to sequentially test the components required to reach its goal without interfering with market activity and without its customers paying for much of the effort. It's a win-win situation that is the direct result of SpaceX using a simple vehicle powered by a reusable engine of its own design that was robust enough to at least allow the possibility of an upgrade to reusability. It took SpaceX a few years to get expanded first stage to fly back to the launch site, but those years were likely to be granted thanks to the company's unique business plan and lack of domestic competition. Thanks for watching, everyone. Did you really understand anything new about rockets and their launch systems? Do you think that spaceflight is a luxury we should enjoy? Let me know what you think in the comments below. Be sure to subscribe, and I'll see you next time on the channel.